Well, before I start, hi everyone. I would like to ask you a question. How much do you know about depression and schizophrenia, apart from the fact that they are diseases? First place, major depressive disorder and schizophrenia are considered as psychiatric diseases. Well, the treatment is a combination of psychotherapy and the administration of some drugs. It involves a multidisciplinary approach for the management of the symptoms. And, well, it's known in the clinical field that the pharmacological treatments generally improve the general condition of the patients, but often fail to achieve a full remission of the symptoms. Why? Because the pathophysiological basis of both diseases are not very known. Most of the known models of disease, they don't answer all the questions that most of scientists ask. And well, although we have a very number of drugs available, the risk of relapse is quite high. So, if you stop the administration of the drug, the symptoms will come back, especially in the case of schizophrenia. A successful treatment, it can be considered as the stabilization of the patient, but not more. You will not cure the patient. In the case of depression, it's a bit different. You can achieve a full remission, but the treatments are quite long. Well, some facts about the theology. For more than 30 or 40 years, the monoamine hypothesis of disease have tried to explain some of the factors that are involved on the apparition of symptoms, and they are based on a neurochemical imbalance of some neurotransmitters. In the case of depression, serotonin, noradrenaline, and dopamine, and in the case of schizophrenia, it's dopamine and glutamine. And there's a serotonin involvement of the neurotransmitter serotonin. But, well, as scientists run short of answers, they are looking for new factors. Among them, environmental factors like stress, personal habits like lack of hygiene, sedentarism, a genetic predisposition, and infection. Some people put the blame on bacteria and virus. And well, more recently, they are considering the influence of neuroinflammation and peripheral inflammation. And that's something quite interesting, because we're talking about brain diseases, but how a peripheral inflammatory state can have an influence on the brain? When we talk about inflammation, we often think of diseases like arthritis, lupus, gout, psoriasis, and some infections. So that raises a question. How inflammation is related with the onset of symptoms in depression and schizophrenia? Well, the number of publications that have addressed this issue is increasing with time. In the last 20 years, we can find, I think, more than 1,000 publications that address this issue. And well, there's some evidence that supports this hypothesis, this inflammatory hypothesis of the depression and schizophrenia. There are more factors, but I decided to mention just the most important ones. Well, the most simple to understand is the relation between the plasmatic levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines in patients that suffer from both diseases. Recent meta-analysis have found a positive correlation between the apparition of symptoms and levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So, in depressive patients, you can find increased levels of interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 6, and tumor necrosis factor alpha, which are pro-inflammatory cytokines, and increased levels of the interleukin 1 receptor antagonist. And in the case of schizophrenia, you can find a similar situation. Well, an interesting fact is the fact that antidepressants and antipsychotics are capable to reduce the plasmatic levels of these pro-inflammatory cytokines. That's one fact. The second fact is the induction of depressive-like symptoms with pro-inflammatory compounds, in this case, cytokines. In animal models of depression, it has been found that through the administration, the central administration, direct to the brain, or peripheral administration of lipopolysaccharide and interleukin 1 beta, there's the apparition of depression-like symptoms. And it's also mentioned the case of anxiety, impaired social behavior, anhedonia, and learned helplessness and despair. And it has been demonstrated that the blockade of the interleukin 1 signaling with the IL-1 receptor antagonist can reduce the severity of symptoms in these models. That's the second fact. The third fact is the manifestation of glucocorticoid resistance. It has been found that in both diseases, there's an increase of the activity of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, and therefore there is an increase of the corticotropin release hormone and the glucocorticoid cortisol. Who triggers this increase? Pro-inflammatory cytokines. And as a consequence, you will find a decreased expression of the glucocorticoid receptor as a compensatory mechanism. So you will find an upregulation of these receptors. And therefore, the consequence is glucocorticoid resistance. And this phenomenon can be found in both depressive and schizophrenic patients. And the administration of antidepressants and antipsychotics can abrogate this effect. This is a new line of research, the formation of tryptophan catabolites. You know, tryptophan is the precursor of the neurotransmitter serotonin. And in physiological conditions, tryptophan can be converted to the catabolite kynurenine by this enzyme, the tryptophan 2,3-dioxygenase, which can be stimulated by cortisol or tryptophan. But what is the interesting thing? That the metabolic pathway of kynurenine can follow two ways, a neurotoxic one and a neuroprotective one that can affect the activity of the glutamatergic system, because the formation of quinolinic acid is an agonist, which is an agonist of the NMDA receptor, can exert an excitotoxic effect on glutamatergic neurons, and the formation, in the other hand, of kynurenic acid, which is an antagonist of the mentioned receptor, can exert a neuroprotective effect, which endogenous compounds can stimulate or increase the formation of both of these, especially of this compound, are cytokines, especially in the microglia. So when you have microglial activation, this group of cells can release pro-inflammatory cytokines, and you will have an excitotoxic effect. Well, another factor is the etiology of other chronic diseases. Now, so regarding that, metabolic syndrome and diabetes mellitus type 2 are inflammatory diseases. In the past, they were considered as metabolic diseases or endocrinologic diseases, but now they are inflammatory diseases because they involve an inflammatory state. Wow, that's a wise statement. And if you can see, some of the factors that are involved in the evolution of the disease consider stress and unhealthy diets, like this sandwich. Well, if you see this figure, you will see that depression, schizophrenia, and these inflammatory diseases are related to each other. They are considered as comorbidities. So people that suffer from depression can suffer from metabolic syndrome or diabetes as well. And it's very common to find in chronic patients they are obese or they suffer from diabetes. What is commonly found of them is the manifestation of a chronic subclinical inflammation. So you don't know. You can guess if the person is inflamed or not, because this increase in some inflammatory markers is so subtle that it's very difficult to note it in clinical terms. So if you ate a sandwich, probably now you are inflamed. I'm not joking. It's a fact. Oh, that's, well, there was a figure there, but I think it's not working. Well, in the case of depression and schizophrenia, it is common to find that most of the patients have an increased body mass index, or they are obese. So we have an inflammation focus because adipocytes are capable to release pro-inflammatory cytokines. So what are the stimuli? If you see that guy eating a hot dog, you will find that the increase of glucose and free fatty acids can stimulate the release of interleukin beta and TNF-alpha. And it has been regarded that pharmacotherapy has an effect because most of the patients that receive a drug treatment, they become more sedentary, but it's not known if it's fault of the drugs or because of the patient that has an pro-inflammatory phenotype. So what we have is the manifestation of a chronic subclinical inflammation and the creation of a vicious circle. So if you don't control the diet of the patient, he will be keeping being inflamed because of the intake of glucose and free fatty acids. Well, and finally, it has been found in some clinical trials that drugs that are not considered as for psychiatric uses can improve the outcome of patients that suffer from all diseases. And as always, our good friend aspirin and the cyclooxygenase selective inhibitor celecoxib. And you can guess why they have antidepressive effects or antipsychotic effects, because they are capable to control inflammation. And recently it has been found that the antibiotic minocycline, which is a tetracycline used for the treatment of acne, has been demonstrated to improve the general condition of schizophrenic patients because of this mechanism. As I mentioned before, it reduces the microglial activation, it reduces the oxidative stress, it controls the conversion of pro-interleukin 1 beta to interleukin 1 beta, because it's an inhibitor of caspase 1, it reduces the activity of the cyclooxygenase 2 enzyme and the release of TNF. So, again, I would like to ask you the same question. Do you think that depression and schizophrenia are inflammatory diseases? Well, in my case, I can answer. But what I can do is to provide some facts. And by the end, what most of the scientists like us we like for is to develop an integrative model which considers not just the neurochemical changes as it was thought at first, but the influence of an inflammatory state of metabolism and drug disposition. So I think we are doing quite good. So thanks for your attention. I apologize for my bad English.
Maybe two questions, and then we'll move on to the next talk. Does anybody have questions? Well, I have a question. So so you showed that IL-1 beta, IL-6, and TNF-alpha are upregulated in both schizophrenia and depression. So how can we, so kind of what steps are there towards sort of parsing apart the relative kind of role of inflammation? Because it's kind of non-specific to both of those psychiatric diseases. So, like, for example, like cognitive deficits associated with depression or maybe non-specific to depression, but kind of what moves are there towards sort of using this as like kind of informative to the specific disease states? Does that make sense? So, so they can't really parse apart the diseases, but are there sort of manifestations of inflammation that are kind of more specific to either depression or schizophrenia? Can they be distinguished on the basis of peripheral cytokines, for example?
Good question. If you read most of the bibliography, you will find that now most of the pathophysiological mechanisms of disease, they overlap. So, for example, in the case of in the case of the formation of tryptophan catabolites, in both diseases, you will find high levels of phenolic acid and cationurin. So you can ask yourself, what triggers that? From what is known now, it has been demonstrated that in an inflammatory state, both compounds are increased. I don't know if I answered your question.
That's great.
Yes. All right,
thank you.
Oh, John. Has anyone looked into the role of whether any of the TNF-alpha monoclonal antibodies used in rheumatoid arthritis, whether patients have less, has anyone looked at the role of whether they could be used therapeutically for schizophrenia?
It has been considered. That someone, I have mentioned the case of the interleukin 1 beta receptor antagonist. It has been shown that the administration in humans can reduce some depressive symptoms. And it's caused, Now some researchers are considering the use of antagonists as a potential therapeutic approach because, for example, when you administer interferon gamma, there's a separation of depressive symptoms after the treatment. And it's the same for TNF-alpha. So I think some people is suggesting now that.
Thank you so much, Pablo.